Praise the Lord, the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. What's up, Brother Maddox? Amen. Well, y'all doing okay? God bless you for coming. Is it cold? Are y'all cold? Feel just right to me. Amen. How many of you love Jesus tonight? Praise report. We got through with the pie auction. Have y'all heard the total of the pie auction, the bake auction for the men? $1,835. You see what the men can accomplish when we beg our wives good enough? And that's exactly where it lay. Ladies, thank you. I'm going on the record live on the internet. Our ladies really, really helped us this time. It's going to provide Christmas for some families. And I just didn't believe. I didn't see this blessing coming. So we're going to be able to finish the sign out back. So many other things. The men are going to get together. Brother Billy, he's got a gleam in his eye right now. That gleam scares me. That means work. But thank you so much for everything that you did to help this make a success. And as husbands, we are indebted to you. So you can just about name your price pretty soon. And come on now. Just about name your price. I'm coming. That's just only
Don't
fair.
Listen to that shit.
That's only fair. Brother Ricky, it's only fair. All the ladies say amen. I'm sticking with the ladies on this one. It's only fair. And so we just had a great time, short day. And but anyway, let me just make a couple of quick announcements, and then we're going to do a couple of songs that y'all are familiar with. December the 11th, we have our children's Christmas play. And I am really looking forward to seeing this production by our children. They have worked for such a long time, and it's getting close. And we're going to live stream it, and it's going to be wonderful. We're going to have a great time. And then that evening now, Sunday the 11th evening, the WMs are having their big party, Christmas party, women meeting party. And so... excuse me. We won't have service that night. So before y'all freak out and say, oh, Lord, we just got in a routine of Sunday night prayer meeting and Sunday night services, this is, we are well established in this now. And so this is a very difficult month, and so a lot of things going on. So, you know, we'll miss a service here, miss a service there. But come January, and we get past the holidays, it'll all be, again, Sunday night, no questions asked. So just remember, now this Sunday night, coming Sunday night, one of my favorite events of the year, Deck the Halls. Deck the halls with balls of holly, la 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 la. Tis the season to be jolly, la 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 la. Well, I tried. So we're going to have a good time, and that takes the place of our Sunday evening service as well. So come, and we're going to decorate and have a good time, and it's going to be a fun time. So that's next Sunday, and then the Sunday after that, the 4th, and then the 11th Christmas play. Now, we will be having church on Christmas Day, the 25th. So just put that. I know you're, as parents, you've got Christmas you know, visitations, Santa Claus, and all of that, you know. But at 9 o'clock Sunday morning, we'll have a candlelight service. We'll have communion and probably the reading of the Christmas story, prayer together, loving one another. Short service, but we need to get together and just celebrate Christ's birth that day as a church family. And so many churches dismiss, and, you know, they can justify it if they want to, but I just couldn't. So that Sunday. We hope you can join us. It'll be here before we know it, just a little over a month away. And so we hope you can join us on Christmas Day, 9 o'clock, and we're going to have a great time that morning. Then you can go back home, and the men can go back to bed while the women cook. So, amen. Amen. Praise God. Would you stand with me? We're just going to relax a little bit tonight. Just going to worship the Lord. You know the song. Let's just worship Him. Come on, brother.
I've heard a thousand stories of your life, but I've heard tender whisper of love, dead of night, and to tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. Your good, good Father, it's who you are. Who you are, it's who you are, and I'm in love by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. I've seen many searching for answers, far and but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, because you know what we need before we say a word. You're a good Father, it's who you are.
Believe it.
You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all. 'Cause you're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are.
Come on, Faith.
It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
You're a good, good Father.
Father, it's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
You know, we're tired tonight, and I know that we are. But we have nothing better to do tonight than to give God praise. He's a good, good Father. Amen. Would you just look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I know you're tired, but I love you. This may be the last opportunity we have tonight just to give God some praise. We may leave this earth tonight via the rapture, and I want to go out singing. Amen. So tonight, press through. I know it's been a long day for you, but let's just lift our hands and let's just sing unto the Lord tonight. Because you're a good, good Father. It's who you are, oh Lord.
It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you.
Yes, I am.
It's who I am, Lord. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, Jesus. You are my song, oh, and you are good, so good. Oh, I said you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh,
hands at myself, the anchor in the way. Jesus, be in my song. Let the king of my heart be the fire inside my vein, the echo of my day. Jesus in my song, because he is good, still good. You are good, you're good. Oh, so good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, so good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, so good. I said you are good. Believe he's good tonight. Now let the king of my heart be the wind inside my sail, the anchor in the way. Oh, Jesus is my only song. You believe that? He's my only song. He's my only song. I don't sing about nobody else, talk about nobody else, preach about nobody else. He's my only song. Let the king of the heart be the fire inside my Holy Ghost fire, the echo of the days. Jesus, he's my song, because he is good. He's good. One more time, I said he is good. Hallelujah. I'm never gonna let me down. That's what Jesus said. You're never gonna let me down. Oh, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let me down. Come on, help me. You're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let me down. No, I said, you're never gonna let me down. Hallelujah.
Perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, in whom there is no variable, no shadow of turning. Hallelujah. Because he's an on-time God. You're good to me. You're good to me. You are good to me. You're good to me. Tired or not, I'm going to sing him. He's good. He's good. He's good. He's good. Wear me out, Lord. You're good. He's good. He's good. He's good. Let me see. He's good. He's good. He's good to me. Yes, you. He is good. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord.
Good, oh, you're good, you're good, Hallelujah. We wait on you, Lord. I mean, since we're here, we might as well have some church. I mean, since we stayed up, didn't get that afternoon nap, we might as well have some church. Since we broke after that bake auction, we might as well come on, give him a praise. That's free. Amen. Do y'all believe he's a good God? Has he been good to you? He can't let me down. Come on, if he'd never let you down, sing it again. Together, give God a clap offering because he's good, good. Oh, you're so good. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, he's a precious, precious, precious God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, I feel a little bit better now. How many of you believe in divine healing? I want everybody to get around my wife. She has, and I'm going to be in trouble, just a bad kidney infection. I believe in the power of God. So I want to sing this one more time because he's good. He's good to my wife. And when she's not worshiping, something's wrong. Talk to me, somebody. So I don't want her to stand up, but I want all the ladies who've ever been healed, believe in the healing power of God, gather around here, slap some oil on her head. Come on, sis. Patrick, get her out there. Put her right back to work. Amen. You are good. You're good. I believe in the blood. Believe in the blood, the power. The power of the blood. The blood never lost its power. There's power in the blood. Healing in the blood. Oh, yes, it is. The blood has never lost its power. I believe that healing, deliverance. Oh, in the blood, heal my wife, touch her in her body. Thank you. the dead. Hallelujah, that's why he's so good. King of my heart, be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is good, he is good, he is good, good. The old timers used to do. They would just start singing, he's good, he's good. They'd sing it for 45 minutes, hallelujah. And the goodness of God would show up. Hallelujah, hallelujah. That's why we sing it like this. Let the king of my heart be the wind inside my sail, the anchor in the way. Jesus is my song. Let the king of my heart be the fire inside my vein, the echo of the day. He is my song because he is good. Tell your neighbor, he's good. They didn't hear you very well, but tell them again, he is good to me and you. Oh, good, good. Give him a praise. If you're sick in your body, praise him. Praising brings healing. Praising brings deliverance. Praising brings joy. Praising God puts the devil on the run. Get hell all nervous because you start lifting up the name of Jesus.
He's good. The devil don't want you to sing it, but I'm going to sing it just because it makes hell mad, my God glad. He's good. He's good. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Can you feel him? Can you feel him? Say, I don't know if I can or not, Pastor. Hallelujah. Give me a knee, somebody. Give me a knee. I just thought I was tired. I just had to get in the presence of God. Well, I'm going to try to hit this note. Well, come on and lift up your hand in a sanctuary. Do I not have Jason? Jeff, he's the one up here.
I'm Dakota.
Come on.
I'm Dakota.
We do on something like that, right? We break them in.
Third string drum.
That's the first string man right there. Y'all ready to give God a praise? This is what we do on Sunday night, amen. Well, lift up your hand in the sanctuary. Lift up your hand in the sanctuary. Joy in the Holy Ghost. I declare joy in the Holy Ghost.
There we are. Now we, she got, whatever you do, don't touch nothing else. Praise hallelujah. Leave it alone. Hey, how's everybody doing? Glory to God. Glad to have you here. Man, what a day. What's up, Bud Patrick? How you doing, Sister Phelps? Y'all all right? Doing? Man, do I? Bless the Lord. Y'all know what we're supposed to do when someone says, bless the Lord. We're supposed to bless the Lord. The Word says, rejoice with them that rejoice. Amen. You know, and when we'd come up, and when I got, because I wasn't raised in this, y'all know that. So when I was taught that, rejoice with them that rejoice, and old Ben Drew would dance, that means get out there and dance with him. Not with him. Amen. But if they took off running, I taught my children, if somebody starts running in the sanctuary, run with them. Amen. That's right. I don't know. You say, those days are gone. It's a shame if they are, but they're not here. Amen. I still like to run. I like to dictate run for me now. So, praise God. Praise God. We've had a great day. I told you, $1,835 in the bag sale. How many of y'all went home and ate some of that cake? Well, that kind of investment, amen. It got greedy. Hey, you know, can I have a piece of that cake? No, not what I paid for it. You can't have none of it, amen. Let you lick the plate when I'm done with it, amen. Pastor, have you put on any weight? Yeah, I sure have. I had 4 pies and 3 cakes, and amen. And some salad that came in the jar. But it was a good day. And again, thank you, ladies. Would not have been possible without you. And the men have so much we want to do and accomplish. Bless people. And we take it upon ourselves to make sure that the house of God, these facilities stay in operation, and a lot of the men that are not trustees, that falls with their job office, you know, they're here working. Brother Billy's here, Brother Jason's here, just because people love being here. They just love being here. And I'll be honest with you. I'll be very honest with you. Can I just be transparent tonight? Man, I'm tired. Y'all wearing me out, but I'm having a good time. I told Dana when she got here, I said, what's the matter, baby? She said, my stomach. And she'd been to the doctor, and we got us a new doctor here in town, just outside town, Sister Ashley, where she works, Dr. Smith. And so they're taking care of us. Amen. And I said, I tell you what I'm going to do. She said, what? I said, man, we're going to sing one or two songs. We're not going to stir the Holy Ghost up at all. I'm going to get out of here. Glory to God. I'm going home. I'm not even going to watch football. I'm going to go lay my head down in my bed, pull the covers up, turn the fan on. Hallelujah. And she said, you know, the Phelps are coming back to hear the rest of that sermon. Ah! Oh! Dog! That's what she said. That's all right. That's all right. All right. Y'all doing okay? Hey, you know, so much is going on in our church. As of last count, because, you know, the new carpet, we have a goal of getting the new carpet by the first of the year, we want to start laying carpet and other things the stage committee wants to do because it's going to pop. I mean, it's going to look so good. And that's the end of the project. As of last week, Brother Billy helped me. What was the total? Where Brother David told us with what we deposited Wednesday night from the cafe? A little over $11,000. So we got about $2,300. So if you have anything left after this afternoon, if I say anything, you know, this is how we do it on Sunday night. If I say anything good, and if you've got anything left, everything goes toward the carpet. And if you don't, listen, that's perfectly fine. We've got so much going on. All right, go to Ephesians chapter 3. Let me finish this, because the last couple of weeks, and Margie Dillon came up to me, and she said this afternoon, she said, Pastor, over the last 2 years, she said, you've done some straight-laced preaching. And, you know, straight-laced preaching, old holiness preaching, consecrated preaching, like we preach here, doesn't fit the modern church today, especially even the Pentecostal church, and I'm Pentecostal. And so a lot of people aren't interested in holiness any longer. And so I've just decided that quality many times is better than quantity. And if I keep just preaching what the Holy Ghost gives me to preach, then you get it, and people around you get what you've got. And there was a lady here today who, Sister Crystal. Sister Crystal, where are you at, Sister? Come here, Sister Crystal. Come here, Sister Crystal. Amen. Grab that microphone off that stand up there and tell them what she told me. She blesses my socks off. Hallelujah. Amen. But, you know, a lot of people, they don't want to hear that when you get saved, you've got to get separated from the world. And I was taught, and this is the only thing I know to preach and teach because it works for me, that when I got saved, my father-in-law said, I want to see some fruit in your life. And they still believe that. And I believe that. Young people, I want to see some fruit. I want to see y'all lose some girlfriends because they don't want to come on and serve the Holy Ghost like you like to serve the Holy Ghost. I want to see some of you girls lose some boyfriends because they don't believe in all that hand clapping. And you know, hey, you can wear makeup if you want to. We're not so strict. No, you can't wear no makeup. Amen. Tell them, Sister Chris, this is going to bless your socks off.
So this week at work, I have a friend that's there, that little short, cute little black girl that was with me today with her little one-year-old baby. She was having a rough week. Her baby's father and her got into a big fight, and it was just really ugly. And I told her, I said, well, why don't you come to church with me Sunday? And she said, well, to be honest with you, I had a really bad experience at my last church. And she said, I don't think I want to go to church anymore. So I said, well, just think about it. And I let it roll on for a couple minutes. And I went back to her and I said, well, you know, you don't have to go to church to be a Christian. And you don't have to go to the doctor to get better either. But it does help. So the next day she came to me and she said, I'm going to come. And she came today and she said that everybody here was just so nice to her. And that she was expecting to get all these dirty looks because she's a young single mom. And she said everybody just, all these strangers just come grabbing her baby and just running off with her. And she said she's coming back. And it really made me feel good.
Amen.
Because she was done with church until she came today.
And she said she's coming back? And Sister Crystal, I said, oh, Lord. She said, don't worry, Pastor. I warned her before she came. And that's good. Warn them because, you know, we're different. We're just different. And you know, we're supposed to be different. We're supposed to be who we are in the body of Christ. And so I make no apology for what God's done in my life and our style of church. And some stand up, I go to preaching, and some stand up over here and say amen out loud, and some wave handkerchiefs, and, you know, and some people think, wow, are they doing that? Hey. You know, it's just a sign that that's good old-fashioned preaching. So anyway, Ephesians chapter 3. We've been praying on Sunday nights too. And listen, we need to pray for our country. We need to pray for our country. I've been saying it. Seems like some people don't want the election to be over. Yes, ma'am. Come here, son. Hey, and where's Dane? Is Dane with you tonight? Dane is somewhere? Okay. And, you know, this is what we do on Sunday night. We'll get to the word. All right, come on, right here. Stand right here beside me. Make me look good, son. Look right in that camera now. Come on now. Either one of them. We got two going live.
All right,
go ahead.
All right, well, this past week at school, we were supposed to turn in this project for my Spanish 1 class, and the project was that we were supposed to make an ofrenda, which is a Spanish word for altar for our dead loved ones. Well, at first, you know, I was battling with whether or not to do it, and so I told my mom and them about it, and, you know, so I ended up not doing it, and I took way she acted about it was like she was somewhat disgusted. And, you know, when I went to school, everybody was asking me, well, you know, they were like, I told them, I was like, well, that's just not, you know, that's not my belief. I'm not going to make an altar for someone that, you know, if it's not God, I'm not making an altar for it. And they were like, well, I'm a Christian. And I did it, and I was like, well, you do what you got to do, and I'm going to do what I got to do. So.
Amen. Amen. Love the fact that these young people listen to their parents and say no, and they've learned something long before they got here. And Dane, their son, y'all know little Dane going around here, he told his mom, they left a couple of weeks ago, and said, Mom, I know what I want to be when I grow up. She said, what's that? He said, a preacher. And so she said, I'm so glad. I must have been doing something right. Now, I want to ask her, Melissa, you live, right? I just want to know, did he ever say that before he met me or what? So, oh, preacher, get over yourself. Hey, man. I'll get over it. But that's so powerful because they wanted him to put, like, pictures of a dead loved one and food and stuff, and it was really an altar. You would sacrifice, and we just don't do that. You say, well, that's just too religious. Yeah, well, whatever. Whatever. Call me whatever you want to. When the rapture takes place, call me gone. Y'all can do whatever y'all want to do then. Y'all ready for me to preach now? Thank you, Brother Patrick. I like you, man. Ephesians chapter 3. Don't stand. We're all tired. I'm standing fast enough. Verse 10. To the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God, according to the eternal purpose which he hath purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of him. Wherefore, I desire that ye faint not at my tribulation for you, which is your glory, according to the eternal purpose. Amen. According to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. You know, in America, Lord, add your anointing to this and strengthen my body. I do feel better. And I'll go to sleep if you allow me to get there. Amen. But right now, let me burn one more time. I yield myself to you. And everybody said, amen. We live in a nation of instant gratification. We want everything now. Young people want everything. This Dana and I worked for 30 years. We went to Taco Bell the other day, and you know me, just outgoing, happy, you know, congenial, egotistical here. I go again, getting over myself. Walked in Taco Bell, and my wife is just beautiful. She's a beautiful lady. And so we walked in, and this young lady was behind the register, and she said, what do you want? And I told her what I wanted, and Dana said, I got the $5 box. I said, well, I'll get the $5 box too. You give me your soft taco, and you can have this out of mine, and, you know, we just switch it up like that. And the young lady, and I said something about Dana and I being married, and Dana said, how'd it happen? Yeah, the look on her face was like, for real? I said, yeah. See this gray hair on my head? Amen. 30 years. And we work hard for what we've got, and we're blessed. And a lot of things we've gotten has been hand-me-down from mom and generational furniture and things. And we're going up soon, and Dana's getting her mama's furniture, stuff that's been in her family for 100 years, and it'll be in my family 100 years, because now I don't have to buy nothing else. Praise God. And But young people starting out want everything that you've worked 50 years to get. And America's the same way. We are a microwave generation serving a crockpot God. You've heard that. And if things don't happen instantly, we think it's not going to happen. But the eternal purpose of God for your home and your life, listen to me, is not an instant thing. It requires brokenness. Brokenness. And the church doesn't like brokenness. We don't want to have our lives broken and shattered in the presence of God because we're afraid of what people will think if we walk into the presence of God and we allow him to break us. But you have to understand the breaking in your life can be healed and you can be built up in the presence of God. It brokenness. It requires
going through seasons of seemingly nothing going on in your life. There were times in our ministry that nothing was happening. There was a time, 6 months, that my phone didn't ring. We were in between positions, and it was a deep, dark time. Broken man. Jace was wanting something, and it was just $10. I didn't have it to give him. I go to my room and bawl and squall and broken. And we have to understand that you're going to go through seasons, young people, where it seems like nothing is going to go right. But if you keep going back to the source, if you keep going back to God, see, this is all I know. This is what works for me. Going to God works for me. I don't need 7 steps. I've got 1 step. All I need to do is find an altar in my car, at my steering wheel, wherever I can. I can get along with God. Going to God works for me. It'll work for anybody, but you have to make up your mind that whatever is going wrong in your life and you're broken, and you're hurting, and you look like your life is over. If you can find enough strength just to lift up your eyes into the hills from which cometh your help and cry out to Jesus and get back to Him, I'm telling you, when you get back to the eternal purpose of God, things work out even when you don't understand. I believe we're living in the moral capital of past generations right now. And we owe it to the next generation sitting right here, and your daughter that was here today. I owe it to them to pour into them the eternal purpose of God. And if we get that into them, then they can attend Faith Assembly. If the Lord should tarry, we need another generation that's connected to the eternal purpose of God. I don't need to teach them to dance. I don't need to teach them to shout. I don't need them to clap their hand. If I'm clapping or dancing or shouting, they see that just about every Sunday here anyway. But if I can get them to connect to the eternal purpose of God, thank you, Lord. In the youth group, they get it upstairs, the eternal purpose of God. To the children's church, they get connected to the eternal purpose of God on their level. And we teach them that, then they understand when they hear me say, or any of the leaders here say, in Sunday school, no weapon formed against you will prosper. They won't understand that revelation if we don't get them to understand connecting to the eternal purpose of God. Not shouting, dancing, hooping, and all of that. I'm talking about good old-fashioned consecration, dedication. No matter what happens in my life, I'm sticking it out with you, God. I'm not going nowhere. I'm not out. I almost found my role right there. And I believe as I teach this, it's important to understand. Like Job, I love Job. I read about Job quite often. Job, you read that book? Listen to me. Job is the oldest book in the Bible, and it's lined and filled with 350 questions. 350 questions in the book of Job. You know why? 350 questions line up in the book of Job? Because Job understood that your life is going to be filled with many questions. There's going to be times in life, young people, where you won't have an answer. You're going to do what Job did. Why? Why? Why, Lord? Why, Lord? Job lost his family. Get this. In one day, he had 10 children, lost his children in one day. Goes to one funeral service and 10 caskets laid out. Lost it all. Lost his health. Lost his will. Even his wife backslid and told him, curse God and die. That's bad. Lost everything. See, I can see his friends sit around, and the Bible said for 7 days his friends sat around and said, you know why you lost your children? Why? Because there's sin in your life. Know why you lost your wealth? Why? Because it's the judgment of God. You know why you lost all your cattle? Why? Because it's the judgment of God. It's the judgment of God. And finally, 7 days of hearing that, he's had all he could take. And I don't know how you see it, but I see him finally standing up one day and say, you know what? I've listened to you. You're supposed to be my friend, and all I've heard from you is negativity. For 7 days, you've not built me up. You've not helped me get back to the eternal purpose of God. You've beat me up. I'm as low as a man can go anyway, and you tell me that I'm under the judgment of God. I'm full of sin, and you know, you got to understand, I'm tired of hearing that. Now I want to tell you what I know. I don't know, Job said, I don't know why that wave hit me. I don't know why the wave crashed against my family. I don't know why I lost my children. I don't know why I lost my family. I don't know why my wife, who I've been married to for 122 years, finally told me to curse God and die. Well, I don't know why she didn't stick it out with me when I needed anybody. I needed her. And I'm here to tell you that there are going to be times when you just don't know what in the world is going on, but you've got to have a relationship with God, because the tide is coming and the wave is coming. The wave is coming, and you've got to be connected to the eternal purpose of God. And as long as you're connected to that tide, the wave will hit, but the tide's going to win. He said this. He said, I don't know why it happened, but he said, I know my Redeemer lives. He said, I may look like a failure. My home looks like a failure. My finances, but I'm a part of the eternal purpose of God. And he said, I know my Redeemer lives. He said, I'm not going to let my present circumstances alter my opinion. God said, I'm going to win and I will win. And then it said, according to that which he had purposed in Christ Jesus. You know what that means? It means it doesn't matter who tries to stop what I'm doing in the earth. Doesn't matter. Listen to me. It doesn't matter who got elected president. It does not matter who got elected. Okay, because I'm going to say some things anyway, because it needs to be said, and it's going all over the world. Whoever sees it, and whoever don't, that's fine with me. You know, the same process that worked for our current sitting president is the same process that worked for the other presidents of the, it's the same process. The American people said, we've had enough of what we think is wrong, and we're going to cast our vote. And it just happened to be Donald John Trump. And I'm sick of crybabies. I'm sick of everybody rioting in the street. I'm not trying to pick on nobody, but let me tell you young people something. I don't owe you nothing. You hear me? Your parents don't owe you nothing. Nothing. If you want a new car, I'm not buying it for it. Go on, get your job, get your own payment book in the mail. Glory to God. Go learn what a hot dog tastes like. Learn what an old burrito in the box that you get from Sam tastes like. Glory to God. Get them boxes of hamburgers. Oh, I feel so bad. Last Wednesday night, Brother Billy and I were on a shoestring budget. We're going to work in the cafe. Pastor Wendell said, what are we going to have? I said, I don't know. He said, hot dogs. I said, man, I can't charge cafe people $5 for a hot dog. I said, well, throw a burger in there. I said, all right, hamburgers and hot dogs. We went to Walmart. Brother Billy and I did. Two tight wads you've ever seen together. Amen. He squeaked when he walked, and I groaned when I walked. Glory to God. We got over there, and the boxes are here, hamburger patties here, and the box of hamburger patties here. This box here had like 30-something in there for like $30, something like that. You know, and they're good burgers. I've had them before, and we like them. They're really good. Right? And this box here, there's like 200 in there for $5. Amen. I said, get that box right there, Brother Billy. Amen. You put them on the grill, and it's just like a grease pit. It just blows up. Amen. You got to have the spray bottle out there. Brother Billy was outside, flames were kissing the ceiling outside. I was running around with my fireman hat on, with a water hose coming behind me. Put that fire out, and he's flipping burgers. He's like the fifth man in the fiery furnace. He's right in the middle of it, flipping them burgers. I said, they're burning, they're burning. He's in there grabbing them. Glory to God. All right, I added some to that, but that's almost all the truth. We got in there, and you poor, precious people ate every one of them nasty hamburgers. Amen. They were bad. Thank you. I love you. God bless you. I know you're sanctified now because you're still here. Amen. So what are you talking about? You know, It doesn't matter who was elected process. The world is in God's control. The last time I checked, he's still on the throne. And everything that's going on in America has caught us off guard. It's not caught God off guard. He is still high and lifted up. He still sits on the circle of the earth. He still uses the earth as his footstool. He is still sovereign. He is still in control. They can riot all they want. They can protest all they want, but they're not going to change anything unless my God gives them permission to do it. You can't move him out of the way. If God says that's my set man or my set woman, you can't move him. You didn't vote God in. You're not going to vote him out. You can't impeach him. And everything, when it's said and done, the ocean is sitting back there saying, I'm not sweating. I don't care how big you are, mountain. The tide's going to win. Thought about Jesus. They just kept coming. They tried to kill him when he was a baby. I love December. I get to talk about my Jesus. Amen. Dedicate the whole month of December talking about my Messiah. Tried to kill him. And I love what the angel told Mary when she had the baby. He said, go and hide in Egypt. After a period of time, the Bible said the angel reappeared and said, everybody tried to kill the baby's dead and they're going back home. Let me tell you something. When they sought to kill the young Messiah's life, let me tell you something. And he said, they're all dead. If you oppose the word of God, people who ever oppose the word of God, they always die. You cannot stand against the word of God. Heaven and earth is going to pass away, but my word will never pass away. As the grass grows and the flowers faded, Isaiah said, the word of God is going to stay. If y'all just help me a little bit, wave a hanky every now and then, I'll just go and cut loose. Amen. And see, you know, people are so worried. They're so mad because Donald Trump won the president. Hallelujah. They're so mad because he won the presidency. They're so mad. And everybody, I mean grown kids sitting outside of college on the concrete crying and bawling like babies. And the professor, he's a bigger nut as they are, giving them Play-Doh and telling them to sit outside and it's okay. I'm glad I'm not your teacher. I'd fail you. I would flunk you. You're going. See, and all these laws that they're passing in America, they've legalized now gay marriage. They've legalized two married, grown, hairy-legged men to climb up in the same bed together. Two old stubble-faced men crawling up in the same bed together, and America's so thrilled that they passed that legislation. And I know, Pastor, that's just wrong. Listen, don't beat up on them. Because they're in a lifestyle that you're not currently in, because it's inside of you too. And just because we haven't been reduced to that type of sin doesn't mean that we're above it. Just thank God we haven't reached that level. Amen. That's why you got to understand. Listen to me. They passed the laws aborting baby since Roe versus Wade. Hallelujah. Came into existence in the 70s. Tens of millions, 40 million babies have been aborted. 40 million babies have been aborted, and I don't know how you think about it, but it's my service, and if you get mad at me, catch me after church, and we'll just hashtag it out, amen. But I'm so glad that at least this president, as I said it last week, I said at least he's saying he's going to stand with Israel, and I stick to my gun there. I'm glad he says he's going to befriend Israel, and I'm also glad he said that he's going to reverse Roe versus Wade. I pray that God uses him to reverse that thing and stop it. Amen. Somebody, you don't have to kill a baby. You can give birth to it and put it up for adoption. I feel like preaching. Glory to God. I wish y'all had some money. I must have got y'all broke this afternoon getting them. They pass all the laws they want to, but you better hear this, preacher. Culture is not winning. Culture is not winning. God's purpose is going to be done. Everything's going to fall in line just like God said it would. Just like God said it would, amen, Israel and his history, they would get to the point that they would get back to worshiping golden calves and idols and things of that. And just when it looked like all hell was going to take over the nation, God would raise up a Samuel. God would raise up a John the Baptist. And I'm telling you, that's why it's important that we get this next generation. James, where's James at? Where he at, huh? He's with the rest of them. That's why it's important that from that nursery over there up to the children's church, to the youth group, that we put in them the eternal purpose of God. We don't know who is sitting in this service. They may be little Rosaline with their feet dangling. They can't even hit the floor. I'm talking about we need to connect the next generation to the eternal purpose of God, and we don't know who is in this sanctuary. I talked to Melissa. I said, ask Kyler and Dane this. And Kyler said he wants to be a coach, and then he said, I want to be a preacher too. I said, ask him if I can share that, and she said they said it was fine. Kyler, that young man that just got up and said, I'm not going to build an altar for this school project. I'm not going to do it. Give me a zero somewhere if you want to, but I'll just find and believe God to give me a favor that when I should have got a B, God's going to give me an A. Amen, somebody. I don't care. You cannot go wrong when you're connected to the eternal purpose of God. Little Dane said, I want to be a preacher. Hallelujah. That is the greatest compliment on a church. That is the greatest compliment on a church. I'm telling you, when young people want to get up and say, I want to be like Pastor Wendell. I want to be like Pastor Smith. I want to be like Pastor Cody. I want to be like Sister Dana. I want to be like Sister Ginger. I want to be like Connie Warren. I want to be like Mr. Durham. I want to be like Pastor Phil. I want to be like Chris. I want to be like them. And man, what a greater testimony. Amen. I wish I could say, if y'all really knew them like I knew them, you may not want to be like them. Amen. And just when it seemed like the church has lost its anointing and its power, because we don't want to confront nothing anymore. We don't want to confront nothing anymore. Let the chairs be full. And you measure your success. I'm just as bad about it as anybody else. I get just as discouraged, amen, as anybody else. But I do know this, that God's going to honor a church that's connected to the purpose of God. If we'll just stay soul-focused and Holy Ghost-focused and freedom-focused and let the Spirit of the Lord, for where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is. We got some freedom up in here. Got some freedom up in here. And when I find something being taught that's wrong, I fix it. You hear me? I'm not going. And when it seems like the church loses its anointing and power, God has a John the Baptist that'll come up out of the wilderness. Amen, somebody. And if you don't want to serve God, don't bust a tube with God just because you get an attitude and say, I'm not going to serve. God will save a wino, drag him out from underneath a bridge somewhere, take a bottle of Mad Dog 2020 out of his hands, take it out of a brown paper bag and clean him up, put a consecration on him, save him, and call him the priest. Just because you won't serve God don't mean everybody won't serve God. And so when you say, I'm not going to clean the church, don't worry about it, honey. God's got somebody that loves walking through here and picking up the tissue and vacuuming the floor and mowing the yard. We don't mind doing these things. I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God anyway. So what are you saying, Pastor? The tide's going to win. The tide is going to win. Pass all the laws you want to. The word keeps going. Amen. Pass all the laws you want to. The Bible said Herod opposed and persecuted all those who were preaching the gospel. And he set himself up to be God. And he became so haughty and prideful, the scripture said this, worms ate him. Worms ate him. He became so proud, and God said, those who get real proud and uppity, listen to me, you better remember one thing. God still got some worms. Amen. I don't know how the worms ate him. I don't know if he was sitting on the throne or in the grave. But the scripture said in the very next verse, that the word of God multiplied and prevailed mightily. In other words, the worm got Herod, but the word got the people. And I'm telling you, if we preach the word, I don't know when, I don't know where, I don't know how. But if we just preach the word, just preach the word, the mercy of God, the love of God, the forgiveness of God, the healing power of God, the virgin birth. See, we don't preach the gospel anymore. We tell you that God wants to bless you with a Lexus. God may not want to give you a Lexus. We need to preach the gospel. It's not about how much money you're going to have in a bank account. What shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his only soul? We don't preach the gospel. We preach prosperity. Nothing wrong with prosperity. God wants to bless you. But we got to get back to preaching the gospel. And the gospel, last time I checked my Bible, which was this morning, the gospel is the birth and the death and the life and the resurrection and the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the gospel. And if we preach that, hallelujah, people get connected to the eternal purpose of God. It looks like the wave is going to break me in failure, Pastor, but the tide of God is going to win. Daniel saw a vision, an image. His head was golden, went down from gold to silver, silver to brass, brass to iron, iron to clay. And it's talked about civilization. I look at America, we started off gold. And from generation to generation, we you know, I was born in 1961. And when I grew up, 9, 10, 11 years old, it was really like Mayberry and Gould, Arkansas. We stayed out until the street lights came on, and that was my curfew. Street lights came on, get home. Amen. That town was so small that they could ride around about 5 minutes and find you somewhere in that town. The worst thing we would ever do, we got in BB war, BB gun war. We'd shoot each other with BB guns. We'd hide, amen. I was a bad shot, too. I really was. But I'd hide in the bush, amen. When somebody walked by, I'd get them in the leg. Pow! I'd shoot them and take off running. We'd pick up Coke bottles out of the ditch and take them to C.C. Roebuck's store, and we'd sell the Coke bottles for a nickel. I've told you that story. We'd get 24 in a case, amen, the wooden crate case, and take them. And Mr. Roebuck would give us the money for it. We'd take it out back, and amen, my friend would be out back, or I'd be out back. And as soon as they set it down, we'd steal it, and amen, take it back in about 3 days. I told you I wasn't raised in church now. You've done some stuff too. See, I grew up in a time where people mattered to one another. I grew up in a time where all you had to do was dial the last four of the telephone number. Amen. How many of you can still remember your grandmother's phone number or your mama's phone number? 2634302. Amen. I'm not talking about 5678909 or whatever that old dumb song was. Amen. I remember you could just dial the last four. We had pay phones. And pay phones in that day, somebody make you mad, you go and you'd call somebody from the pay phone across from Fisher's Market. I'd call them up and I'd tell them, I'm mad at you or whatever. And then instead of hanging the phone up, I'd hang it up. I'd put it up on top of the phone. And they never could hang their phone up. It kept their line. It kept their line open. They'd have to leave home and go find that phone somewhere. Don't wow me, sister. Amen. That's a good memory in my book. Amen. I love telling that story. That's the truth. Amen. I wish I could do it again to some of you people. Amen. Glory to God. David said, and like in America, it's not the same America. We don't love our neighbor like we used to. We don't care for one another. We've got 114 million people full-time working and 106 million people on welfare. Something needs to be fixed. Men won't get up and go to work. Get up, boys, and go to work. If a man don't work, bring something to the table besides a plate. Pastor, what's that got to do with the gospel everything? Amen. The Bible said, watch this. He said, and every generation starts out gold, and it went to silver, it went to brass, all the way to iron, all the way down to clay. It represents even our nation. See, we started out as gold, but with every generation, it seemed like there's a watering down, a dunging down of morality, of ungodliness, and spirituality, and a love for Jesus Christ. We tell people you can live any way you want to and still go to heaven, but that's not the gospel. Why even say a prayer if you're going to keep living the way you're living? If you don't intend to change, why say a prayer? David said, watch this. David said, we've gone from gold to silver to brass to iron, and I believe prophetically we're at the clay feet. I believe that's where we are. And he said, David said, suddenly I saw on top of that mountain a stone. And David said, that stone is Jesus Christ, the rock of my salvation. And Jesus is the chief cornerstone. And the Bible said that it started rolling down the mountain. And I'm telling you, that's the original rolling stone. Amen. And it rolled down the mountain against the mighty kingdom that had been in the earth, and it hit the clay feet of that image, and it tore. It represents the financial, political kingdom. And when he said it hit the civilization, they all toppled over on his feet, and that culture fell over and was destroyed. Then he said that rock began to grow. In other words, the kingdom of this world become the kingdoms of my God. I'm telling you again, just as I'm standing here, that one day every one of us is going to stand before God. That's why you got to have a relationship and be connected to the eternal purpose of God, because you're not going to die and go to the grave and come back as a cat or a rat or a bird. You're going to stand before God Almighty. That's why I tell people that say, you know, the Big Bang evolution, I don't believe in it. I believe God created. I am a creationist. God said and it became. That's just how I roll. Amen. God said, and I also believe that one day every person in this room, I've been to Calcutta, India, where they believe in reincarnation, and they won't kill the cow because that might be great-great-granddaddy from another lifetime. Let me tell you something. Who wants to believe that garbage? I'm connected to the eternal purpose of God. In his image I have been made. In his image I have been fashioned. And in his image and in his likeness, I have been created. And one day I'm going to stand before him. And every knee's going to bow. Every tongue's going to confess. All these people, y'all okay? I need to hurry up and get out of here, but I'm on a roll now. Miley Cyrus, all these other people say they're going to leave the United States if Trump wins the presidency. All I can say is bye. If you can leave this country that's been so good to you, I'm not trying to be soapboxy, I'm really not. But if they can leave this country that's been so good to them because they didn't get their way, I don't owe them nothing. I don't let my kids watch them anyway. That comedian, that filthy mouth woman comedian, I don't even know who she was. She just made the news because she started bawling. I thought, good Lord, you know, my mama raised me. Don't show my business in public. Keep me on Facebook too, amen. I'm leaving the country if Trump gets elected. All I can say is bye. You want me to quit living my life because you're supposed to entertain me or something? And the word says this, the kingdoms of this world will become the kingdoms of our God. It makes no difference. The king of Saudi Arabia is going to bow his knee. He's going to answer to God just like I am. Obama, Clinton, Bush, both Bushes, amen. Roosevelt, And Trump now, praise God, they're all going to bow their knee one day and answer before God. That's just how it is. That's just how it is. See, it's all coming down just like the book said. It's coming down just like the book said. And the kingdoms of this world are on his clay feet. And he could come tonight. He could. The question is, and I know you are you ready? Are you ready? Bible said, Daniel said this. I'll close it and leave it. Daniel said, they that know their God shall be what? Strong and do exploits. That's right, Sister Junior. You know, we need a strong church. We need a church with a backbone that won't bow down to anything, won't give in, won't give up. Amen. That's going to say, this is what we believe, this is who I am, and I'm not changing for anybody. Amen. We can get together and amen and watch a ball game. I need a hot dog, and I can have a good time doing that. I don't need Budweiser. I don't need all of that. Amen. We can talk about Jesus. Amen. If you let me get a big swallow of that hot dog down, I'll talk about Jesus some more. Amen. We can have fun. Amen. Stand with me. I tell you, you got to get connected to the eternal purpose of God. Listen, this is where we pray on Sunday nights. I want us to pray, seriously, because I know some of you think, well, Pastor, you're just awful. Awful strong on, you know, picking out people. Listen to me. We need to just let these people know, you don't run my life. You don't run my life. You don't tell me. You can stay over in Hollywood if you want to. You can do whatever you want to. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. You can swing naked on a big old steel ball if you want to. You can have a wrecking ball if you want to, but the kingdom of this world is going to become the kingdom of our God. Amen. We need to pray for America. These kids that are having a meltdown because they didn't get their way. We need a loving God to be able to visit them and tell them that there's hope for them. It's just an election. Amen. Now, forgive me for saying this. Someone go stop that internet service. Amen. If we can live 8 years of Barack Obama, we'll survive 4 years with Donald Trump. We will. We will. You know why? Because Donald J. Trump is not dictating what this book said would happen. So let's pray for America. Let's pray for our nation. For healing. For healing. And Pike County, Mississippi can experience the healing power of God. Find a place of prayer. Pastor Wendell, if you'll put a little music on for me, please, sir. We'll have a little worship music. Amen. Somebody. And let's find a place of prayer. And let's call out to God on in prayer and separation.